Well, good evening, bonsoir. Welcome to today's event, the Total E&P Distinguished Speaker Series that's co-hosted by TICED. And so today we have our distinguished speaker for 2015. I should say a word about the Total E&P Distinguished Speaker Series. So this is enabled by Total, through a gift from Total, and it allows us to showcase important and new sustainable initiatives from around the world. I see lots of familiar faces, and perhaps there are some who I haven't had the chance to introduce myself to. So my name is Subhashish Ghoshal. I'm a professor at McGill's Faculty of Engineering, and I'm the director of the Trottier Institute for Sustainability in Engineering and Design, or TICED, at McGill. So we all know that climate change and overconsumption is leading to uncertain water supplies all over the world. And the California drought in particular has brought the issue of water scarcity to a large population to the forefront and to the front pages of our newspapers. We've all been reading lots about this. And we really need very innovative and interdisciplinary thinking to address problems such as this and to create lasting solutions. So today's talk will showcase some groundbreaking ideas about how to deal with uncertainty in water supplies and water scarcity. And so it's my privilege to now introduce our distinguished speaker, Dr. Richard Luthy. Dr. Richard Luthy is the Silas H. Palmer Professor of Civil and Environmental Engineering at Stanford University. Dr. Luthy has received many distinguished awards over his career, and I'll just mention a couple. Earlier this year, Dr. Luthy received the Gordon Maskew Fair Award, awarded by the American Academy of Environmental Engineers and Scientists for significant contributions to the practice of environmental engineering and improvement of the world's environment. Dr. Luthy was made a member of the prestigious US National Academy of Engineering in 1999. And in 2003, he was made a fellow of the Water Environment Federation. Dr. Luthy, apart from being a professor in civil and environmental engineering at Stanford, is also a senior fellow at the Woods Institute for Environment at Stanford and director of a large NSF initiative, the NSF Engineering Research Center for Reinventing the Urban Water Infrastructure. So we're honored to have Dr. Richard Luthy with us here today and to give this presentation on sustainable urban water supplies in California. And I'll turn over that one to you.
Great. Thank you very much. You have to stay here a minute. Okay. Subhash has failed to mention that I was his PhD advisor, and we worked very closely together for about 5 years, and I always cherish those times. So thank you for inviting me.
Thank you very
McGill.
Much. Okay.
So this is my first trip to Montreal, except for the airport and changing planes. I'm very glad to be here, and thank you for coming out for this presentation. So the topic today is about urban water supplies in California, and these are the main points that I'd like to mention. I'll come back to this later as a concluding slide, but the way for us to help meet our urban water supply challenges in California means that we need to do more in terms of recycling and energy recovery, and that the strategy for that is to think about decentralized systems and using new technologies. We have another source of water that's been overlooked in the past, and that's stormwater. The big cities in California are on the coast, and when we have large storms, that water has been managed for flood control, not for water supply. So we're taking a new look at stormwater in the big cities as a way to collect and recharge urban aquifers. And I'll show you some pictures later that if we do this in an appropriate way, it can enhance urban amenities as well. But for these strategies to be realized, we need to be able to demonstrate what we're talking about first in pilot plant systems and then in demonstration scale. And in our field, if you can demonstrate something at large scale, basically have the prototype of a full system, then that becomes believable. Along with this, we need decision support tools to ask the question, now how's this really going to build out, or how's it going to work? So those are the main points. I have just a couple of slides about water in California to sort of frame the discussion. The first one here shows where our water supply comes from in a normal year. Where it comes from is snow that's captured in the Sierra Nevadas. Those are the high mountains that are east of the Bay Area. And that snowmelt provides water to the San Francisco Bay Area and to Southern California. We also depend a lot on our reservoirs and also groundwater. So this is how things look in a sort of an average year. But as you know, in California, we've been experiencing this drought. And this is what things look like in a drought. There's essentially no snowpack. The reservoirs are emptier. And we rely on groundwater. And if you look at the groundwater elevation between these two slides, you can see it dropped. And it drops precipitously because in many parts of the state, particularly in agricultural regions, we don't manage our groundwater sustainably. So we have real problems here then in California with meeting our urban water supply needs. And it comes from new realization of climate change, the fact that we do have population growth, and also that we can't take all the water and use it in the urban environment or for agriculture. We have to leave water for ecosystems too. And we hadn't really thought about that or paid so much attention to it in the past. But nowadays the need to leave water for the environment is another need, a new realization that has come about with the Endangered Species Act and the like. So just to show you a graphic of what it looks like. This is in the Sierra Nevadas. Now, Governor Brown is our governor. He's in his second term. It's actually his second stint as governor. He was governor in the 70s and then came back. But he's up here in the Sierra Nevadas with this gentleman who's the chief of snow surveys. And on April 1 of each year, they go measure the snowpack in the Sierra Nevadas, and they determine the water equivalent and how much runoff there'll be. So here they are doing that. But, of course, there's no snow. And this is a photo op, you know, obviously, to show here we are. For the first time since these snow surveys began in 1940, there's no snow to measure. So this highlights the problem we've had in that 2015 was the driest year on record in California. Now, records go back to the gold rush. That's, 1849. So this is a drought of big proportions. Now, in terms of weather, this year is going to be a little different. We think we'll have these big rains that will come in with El Nino. And El Nino has to do with the warming of the water in the Pacific, and then these big storms that will come in and likely put a lot of water in Southern California. Some will make it to Northern California. There, because of the warmer rains, there may be less snowpack, but we're all looking forward to this. We've had some preliminary rains already, and we're looking for these drenching rains that will come in January, February. Here at McGill in Montreal, this will mean likely a very mild winter. We'll have a wet winter, and at least that's what we hope, and you'll have a nice mild winter, which I guess is okay unless you like to ski. So what does all this mean in terms of our urban water? Well, the El Nino is not going to be drought busting because we've had many years, decades of unsustainable water management. So the way to think about things in the future is we need to think differently about our urban water systems and where we get water. We're at the limit of any water that we can import. There's no more water to import. We've taken it all in California. We've taken as much as we can from the Colorado River, and so we're essentially on our own. So I've circled two things here, that the water we have available to us is runoff and wastewater, and we should be thinking about doing new and different things with those to help meet our water supply needs in the future. So in our center on reinventing the nation's urban water infrastructure, we look at closing these loops where stormwater and recycled water can become part of our potable water supply. We can replenish our urban aquifers, and if we manage the rivers and streams near our cities well, we create these urban amenities and also help contribute to our water supplies. So our goal here is to look at how to close these loops. And so now I'll talk about these two circles here. One is on wastewater and the other one on stormwater runoff. So the way in the future, I believe, is to think about water reclamation in new ways than we have in the past. Now in California, we do reclaim wastewater. We use it for irrigation. The challenge with that is that that water is collected at central plants, and it's very difficult to use that water outside of the close vicinity of the wastewater treatment plant. Sort of a joke in California is if you want to find the golf, if you find a golf course, there's a wastewater treatment plant nearby because they're irrigating it with recycled water. So a way in the future then would say to sort of break this mindset of the centralized system and think about a decentralized water reclamation. And I'll use this example here of Palo Alto and the main central water pollution control plant. And imagine that you could think of a system where you have satellite treatment plants. And the advantage of the satellite treatment plants would be that you could reclaim the water where it's generated and needed. And that these don't have to be full wastewater treatment plants. You could still take advantage of the existing sewers and the like to deal with residuals and solids. And the best solution here, probably in the future, is to think about a hybrid operation of satellite plants working in concert with these centralized facilities. Now, if we think about centralized facilities, we're sort of wedded to things that were built a long time ago. Maybe they haven't worn out yet, but we have an in-place technology. For the satellite treatment plants, we have the advantage to do, if we're gonna build them, we can say, let's use new technologies that are very energy efficient, that produce few residuals and have a small footprint. So there's an opportunity here now to reinvent part of our system. So to illustrate these points, I show here a map of Palo Alto. The Stanford campus is at the end of that arrow where it says 5 miles. The main plant is near the bay. That would be in the upper right of that picture. Well, if we want to, say, reuse water in the Stanford campus, that plant is 5 miles away and about 100 feet or 120 feet downhill. So there's no pipeline taking that water back to Stanford. So a problem here then is that you would have to dig up city streets, put in a large pipeline, and pump the water back uphill. That's energy intensive. And putting in pipelines in city streets, this can be on the order of $2 million a mile. And this is the greatest hindrance right now in terms of water recycle, is this need to trench and to put in a different kind of a distribution system, now distributing reclaimed water. So if we had a satellite plant like there on the Stanford campus, we could take that water and put it right into the campus irrigation system, for example. And so the point is then, is that we would avoid pumping uphill, we would avoid having to put a pipeline through the middle of Palo Alto. There's another thing too, two examples about water quality. One is that the large sewers, when they get near the fringe of the bay, they will tend to infiltrate water. And that water that's infiltrated is brackish water from the bay. So I've shown you examples here where there's been some surveys done to show where there's this intrusion, as we call it, this intrusion of salty water into the sewers. The sewers are not pressurized. They drain by gravity. So they act as little collectors for this brackish water. Well, if you when we talk about water recycle, often what comes up is, what are the chemicals in the water? Is it safe? And the like. What about pharmaceuticals and what about personal care products and that? And admittedly, that's important. But the overriding issue with irrigation and using reclaimed water is just plain old salt management. How can you put water in the soil year after year and avoid the salt buildup? So salt management becomes really important here. If we use water that's farther up in the distribution system, there's less salt in it. So I illustrate that here, that on this corner of campus is where the sewers all converge, that salt content is fairly low. Our water comes in as snowmelt from the Sierra Nevadas. So it's very low in salt content. The wastewater has about 350 or so ppm of salt. But down at the bay, that salt content is more than doubled. What that means is that that's problematic for long-term irrigation. So if we think about what's best for long-term irrigation and salt management, you'd want to use water at the lowest salt. We don't have to desalinate that water. We could at the centralized plant, and San Jose does that. But if we captured it further up in the system, we would avoid those costs. Another thing I mentioned earlier was that if you think about water reclamation and building a satellite plant, we could do it with new technologies. And that's illustrated here, that we could imagine new technologies, if we could demonstrate them at some scale, where we would recover the energy from the, what's called the chemical potential energy, the energy that's embodied within the chemicals that are in the wastewater. What we do now is what's shown in this lower middle picture, is we add a lot of oxygen to our wastewater treatment plant. The wastewater treatment plant produces a high quality water, safe to discharge to the bay, but it's extremely energy intensive. You're adding all that oxygen with all that aeration, and you're converting organic matter to CO2. A different strategy would say, let's rethink this system now, and imagine we could do it by complete anaerobic processes. And this is something 50 years ago, it was believed it wouldn't work. And that's why these other kind of systems were built. They're tried and true. But if you went to a complete anaerobic system, taking advantage of new fluidized bed membrane processes, you could convert more of that organic matter to methane. And you could capture the methane and use it to run the plant. So it becomes almost energy neutral to reclaim water. It sounds a little bit magical, perhaps. But that's because we're used to this other strategy aerating and the like. For the city of Palo Alto, for example, the city's biggest electric bill are those tanks. It's not the streetlights. It's those tanks that provide all that energy for that aeration. So if we compare anaerobic and aerobic membrane bioreactors, and my colleague Perry McCarty has done this, I'm showing you two things here, is that on the left picture, it's the methane production. It's twice as much with anaerobic treatment. Now, aerobic treatment, you do get biosolids from primary treatment. You grow bacteria, and you can digest that, and you get some methane from that. But you get twice as much if you can go to a complete aerobic system or anaerobic. And the other one, the picture on the right shows now this energy balance for the anaerobic versus aerobic. Blue is produced, red is used. Well, you can see with the aerobic system, you imagine subtracting out that little bit of red from the blue, you're generating about 0.6 kilowatt hours per cubic meter. With the other system, you're using that much energy, 0.6 kilowatt hours per cubic meter. So these systems can become very close. If you do all the solids processing, they can become energy positive. We think maybe if we just go to the, don't process the primary solids, you'll be close to maybe to energy neutral. Another question comes up when we do recycling water. There is this question about pharmaceuticals and personal care products. And if I had to say, who's our greatest skeptic here about whether or not we can reclaim water and use it locally on the Stanford campus for non-potable purposes, the biggest skeptic is Joe Stegner. Now, who's Joe? Joe is our head of the Department of sustainability and energy management. And he in the water department says we need to show that if we reclaim water and use it for irrigation or for vehicle washing and the like, we need to be able to demonstrate that it's safe. And when they think of safe, they think of personal care products and pharmaceuticals. And so this slide shows the comparison of the anaerobic fluidized bed membrane bioreactor with the conventional aerobic system using some data that Bill Mitch and colleagues went to Korea to sample. And the story here is that when you look at these pharmaceuticals, like atenolol or carbamazepine or metoprolol and the like, from the anaerobic process, the height is shown there in yellow. Well, basically, they're completely removed. If you look at the aerobic process, well, some of them are in completely removed. But the anaerobic treatment then, new technology, could provide a way to capture the water locally using a small footprint, have less salt in it, avoid pumping the water back uphill, and produce an overall better quality water. So with all this, then it says, okay, let's do it. But we need to be able to demonstrate at some scale that this will actually work. Now, there's no plant like this in the Western Hemisphere. By the way, Shubashis, that includes Canada. No plant like this in the Western Hemisphere. So what we've done in ReNUWIt, that's our center, is working with the university and alum to build a pilot facility. And it's under construction now. This picture was taken several weeks ago. The goal here is to show at scale of a few gallons a minute how this will really work. So this is a pilot scale system. But after running this for a while, we then would hope that one of the utilities will step forward and say, okay, we would like to demonstrate this at larger scale. And once you've done a demonstration, then others, our experience in California is once you do a demonstration, you've kind of de-risked the technology. Regulators understand it, vendors understand it, engineers understand how to design it, and then others will adopt that. But you need a first adopter. And here, Stanford is committed to managing their water in a more sustainable way, and we were able to raise the funds for this. Now, this is $3.5 million. So this is not a trivial thing. It's a lot of effort went into the fundraising, and then in talking to the president and provost when I did, the story kind of tells itself in a way. You could say, you know, in the future, our ability to put new dorms on campus, to put new laboratories in, may not depend on a donor, but may depend on whether or not we have the water. And that's a story that gets traction. And so we're okay today with our water, but if you look down 50 years, we're not. If we get a severe drought cutback, we're short. So the idea is to do these things now to prepare for the future. So when the time comes, you can build these out, you'll be ready to go. And that's a story, thank goodness, that our president and provost and, you know, the folks in I mentioned Joe, but a whole group in utilities are behind us on this. The other thing I wanted to mention then is about how can we think about sustainable water management is to look at stormwater and now as a source of our water supply. And stormwater in the Midwest and the East Coast is collected in combined sewers. Yeah, out west, the cities grew up in a different era, and most of the cities you have separate sewers. In other words, the stormwater is in one pipe and the sewage is in a second pipe. So in the East Coast, the concern is combined sewer overflows, and when you get big storms, not to flood out a wastewater treatment plant. In the West Coast and Southwest, we've been managing the stormwater for flood control, but that with that flood control, pushing that water to the ocean as quick as you can, you get beach pollution, and that's what happens in California and elsewhere. So we're looking at this strategy now of saying, well, maybe we should rethink this infrastructure that we built some time ago with respect to the way we manage stormwater. So I've been serving as a chair of a National Research Council committee on beneficial use of stormwater, and this is a picture I got for our report. And it shows the combined sewers where they are in the U.S., and then they're by these little dots. Where are all the dots? Well, they're in the Midwest and the Northeast. There's two dots in California, one in downtown San Francisco and downtown Sacramento. And why there? Well, it's because those were the first cities that were built when they started out with combined sewers. Everything else built after that doesn't have it. But, excuse me, those cities started with the gold rush. So we don't have the, we have the separate sewers, but we've been managing these for flood control. So I show these pictures of these of the Los Angeles River here. These are these concrete channels that you see in Hollywood movies. I'm a big fan of action movies, and that picture down, I don't know if you remember The Terminator, but there's a chase scene in that. There's other movies you, there's a Bruce Willis movie where he had to get away from the bad guys and he jumped in the sewer, and my wife said, oh no, he jumped in the sewer. I said, oh, wait a minute, this is a storm sewer. It doesn't have sewage, and then sure enough, he ends up climbing out there. But that's what we have, and it works for flood control, but it's wasting the water, and it's also very unattractive. If you've been to Los Angeles, these look, they're just stark, and yeah. The other thing that happens is we get the beach pollution. So you gather up all that stormwater, and you put this water to the ocean, and then you have this problem. And this was a story from the New York Times a couple of years ago, talking about, you know, maybe we could collect that water and solve two problems at once. Make it be part of our water supply and solve the beach pollution problem at the same time. So last year, our friend Governor Brown signs this stormwater capture bill. This was last October. And in this bill, they mentioned that, you know, there's a potential to capture a lot of water. Now, in America, we use these funny units of acre feet, which is about a third of a million gallons in round numbers. But it, obviously, it comes, do you use acres in Canada? No? Well, okay, acre. Well, you know, it's a metric, a unit of measure that comes from agriculture. An acre foot of water is like three football fields a foot deep. So there's a lot of water to capture, and different cities are looking at how we might actually capture this and use it. So this is a picture from Los Angeles Department of Water and Power. And Dave Pettyjohn and others in LADWP are members of our center, and we've been working with them on how to think about stormwater management. But what these two pie charts show, the one on the left is where the city gets its water today, and shown on the right is where it will be in 20 years. Well, what's interesting about the picture on the left, you'll see that thing called MWD. That's the Metropolitan Water District. That's the big wholesaler of imported water. Now, so that right now the city is more than half dependent on imported water. And their strategy for the future, not because of this drought, but the one that was in the around 2007 and 8, Los Angeles, then Mayor Villagrosa said, you know, we need to reduce our dependence on imported water. And then that way we can survive droughts better. And so a picture that came about is shown here for 20 years later. In absolute terms, the amount of imported water is cut in half. Even with population growth, it's cut in half. And then where does that other water come from? It comes from various places, but one place is stormwater. And it shows here that maybe you could capture 4% of that and have it contribute to the water supply. I'll show you in a moment, this number could really be somewhere between 10 and 20%. It's a conservative number, and the city didn't want to overcommit at the time. But then you have Mayor Garcetti, who looks at the drought we have now and said, you know what, we're not going to do this in 20 years. We're going to do it in 10 years. So there's a lot of interest in the city to look at now this stormwater anew. And this is a picture from Rafael Villegas and others who've been working with Geosyntec and other consultants on developing a stormwater capture master plan. And what's shown over here on the far far left is the current use of precipitation in the city. The existing spreading means capturing water at the foot of hills and putting it into spreading grounds. The light green there is the incidental recharge. That would be the precipitation that just finds its way into the ground. Not all of that is available for groundwater extraction, but that number is, the two together, are just under 100,000 acre feet. Well, what can happen in the future? With a conservative future, where you might be in 20 years, is that number could double, get close to 200,000 acre feet. And if you're aggressive in this century, that number could be closer to 300,000 acre feet. And now we're talking about 20% of the city's water, 25% of the city's water. It is a big deal. But we have challenges in how we capture stormwater in California. It's easiest when it rains and doesn't rain and doesn't rain. But as you know, we have a Mediterranean climate. It rains roughly from in December, January, February, then less in March, a little bit in November. Then after that, it doesn't rain. It's nice for planning outdoor events, but it means that if you collect water during the time of the rain, you really need it about 6 months later. So you need a rain barrel, except it needs to be a really big rain barrel. And this is a picture of storage that an environmental group known as the Tree People have built at their headquarters, which is based, this is an environmental education center, and they collect the water so they can irrigate their grounds and flush toilets and that kind of thing, use the stormwater for those purposes other than just drinking. And you see what's constructed here. It's a 200,000 gallon tank. Now this is quite an undertaking here. This is not a 50 gallon barrel. This is 200,000 gallon barrel, but that's only 2/3 of an acre foot. So you see the problem here now. If you're going to collect this stormwater, and that's the challenges in how you collect it, the place to put it is in the ground. Put it and let the ground and the aquifers become your rain barrel. So in our center, this is what we are studying: stormwater capture, treat, and recharge. And I show this as a series of steps here. You may not do all these steps, but basically you would take the stormwater that enters from the left here, goes through a screen, and then goes to a capture pond. And this pond then would hold the water for a while, and in that pond you'd have solid settle, and you might get some photolysis occurring as well. And then you go through a series of filters, and these would be filters that would be designed for long-term operation. A sand iron filter with iron filings to remove phosphorus and heavy metals by complexation and precipitation. And then a biofilter that could remove nitrate, so you don't put nitrate in the ground. And then some geomedia like oxides of manganese or biochar for the final trace organics removal. And then from there it goes to the groundwater recharge. Our hypothesis in this is that these little filters would work better in combination than they would as individual units. But think of this as what a modern system might look like, where you capture the stormwater, you treat it at a controlled rate, your capture pond is your hydraulic buffer, and then you put it into the ground, and your ground is your rain barrel. So this is my sketch when I talk to folks like yourselves, but what might this actually look like if I were going to explain this to a general public audience. Well, we have a picture of this. This is an example for the city of Los Angeles that's taking an abandoned sand and gravel quarry and converting that to a stormwater capture system. Now, this area here was a 45-acre abandoned quarry. Basically, it's an urban blight. And the idea is to convert that system, that urban blight, to something that provides for water supply and community amenities. And you can see some of the community amenities shown here in this diagram. Now, when you can do this, and another picture of this is shown here, when you do this, these are the things that get a lot of public attention. This is the kind of thing the Tree People like. In LA. It's the kind of thing the Sierra Club likes, and the Heal the Bay people and the surf riders like it. They can look at this system and say, well, if we capture stormwater, it's less beach pollution. If we capture stormwater, it means we're not dependent on imported supplies. And if we do it right, we can make this thing look more like a park. And you can see some of the park-like features here in terms of basketball courts, tot lots, walking trails, and that kind of thing. And so it's this, then, that captures the imagination of elected officials, and it means that the city, then, with the flood control district, would put up close to something like close to $30 million and buy this site. Now, the site's a dump, but, you know, property's valuable in Los Angeles no matter what it is, and it still costs that. But the realities of what this looks like, I have a picture here on the left that shows that pit as it exists today. It doesn't look anything like this nice green picture. What's not shown in these pictures is just what's uphill or up gradient from this site. And that's all these automobile salvage yards. I didn't know about this before until I started working in LA, but I learned where all the cars go in LA. They go to these salvage yards here in this lower San Fernando Valley. And believe me, there's a salvage yard for every make of car. There's some German guys that run the BMW one. There's other people that do Toyotas, or other do Hondas, or some that only do Fords. It goes on like that. And there's kind of miles of these things. So what's the deal there? Yeah. So we're not talking about stormwater runoff from your driveway or your lawn or something. We're talking about runoff from urban hardscape. And so what is that? Well, that means we have lots of contaminants in this. We have pathogens we worry about, but urban use biocides, and one that we've been studying is fipronil and diuron. These are not the kinds of chemicals you find in wastewater. It's not the kind you find in a hazardous waste site, but they're used in the urban environment all the time. And two other chemicals we've been studying are these triazoles. You see mercaptobenzothiazole and benzotriazole. These are compounds that are used as anti-corrosive agents, and also the mercaptobenzothiazole is an additive in tires. It's maybe in tires about weight 3% or 4%. So when you have this urban runoff, you get a whole, you get a lot of this. And the challenge for us then is to say, well, okay, how do we, if we collect up this water, we run it through that wetland, like that site I just showed you, how can we be sure that we're not putting these chemicals in the ground? And that's where we step in and are working with the city. The standard for stormwater treatment is what's called best management practices. It's just basically a standard design. You comply by building it, not by showing that it works. So a standard design here is you have a bit of spec soil with some mulch and gravel, and that's it. If you do that, then you have the best management practices, and that's supposed to work. The problem is these things aren't designed for specific contaminant removal, the kind of thing I showed. Those triazoles are very soluble in water. They don't sorb onto particles. They'll move through a system like this. So when we think in the future, then, we need to come up with new kinds of way to treat this with water. And what we are looking at are examples of engineered media. And this could be biochar, for example, or it could be iron filings from scrap metal. And use these advantageously, we might think also of oxides of manganese. But this is what we're exploring, how we can take these kind of materials that we hope would be long-lived in a stormwater system, that maybe they don't need to be replenished for a few years once they're installed. But we need to show that they work and how to design them. So Ali Baim, who works with me, office is next door, she's been studying these kind of materials for removal of pathogens. These are the data for E. coli. The thing to call your attention to is the bottom bar. With a certain kind of biochar, it seems to work very well under the wet and dry cycles you'd have with stormwater. It means sometimes it's wet, sometimes it's not, and also in the presence of natural organic matter. What this could achieve then is maybe 2-log removal of E. coli, and that would mean that that water then would be safe for recreational use and that sort of thing, but the water could go into the ground and the rest of the pathogens are taken care of by groundwater treatment or by groundwater flow and by treatment at extraction wells. There is interest in nitrate removal, more so in the east, but we're also looking at how we can do this for our stormwater capture But what we're interested in here is how we could use wood chip bioreactors. And the idea is this, is that if you take stormwater and pass it through wood chips, you'll deplete the oxygen, and then fungus that would grow in that entrance section of the wood chip reactor will degrade a little bit of the cellulosic material in wood chips, and then that can provide the organic matter, degradable organic matter for the denitrification reactions. And that's what we've been studying as a way to remove nitrate. And our data are shown here under two different pore water velocities for nitrate removal. Now, stormwater won't have 10 unless you're in an agricultural area, but we want to test sort of the limits of this and what we might be able to achieve and use data like this for nitrate, dissolved oxygen depletion, and the dissolved organic carbon generation, and put this together in a model to be able to predict how these things would work. But we've run these reactors now for like well over a year, almost 2 years, and they work. They seem to have a long life. Our challenge is then to be able to model them. And then my colleague Dave Sedlak at Berkeley has been working on oxides of manganese to remove trace organics. And this shows data for bisphenol A. And his student, Joe Charbonnet, you know, says that these media should work very well if your oxidizable organic matter is very low, like 50 micrograms per liter. He predicts a very long life here. And if we precede these manganese oxide coated sands with those other treatment units, you may actually achieve something like that. So this is what our systems comprise of as separate units, but how would this work? This is what we're testing out at a field site up in Sonoma, which is just north of San Francisco in Marin County. And their strategy for stormwater management is first flood control, second groundwater recharge. And they're partnering with us on studies here to look at how this combination of the iron filings plus sand, the wood chips and the biochar and the manganese could all work together so that we end up with a good quality water when we put it in the ground. So this is where we are today. We've done these separate tests of the systems, and then we're putting together as combined systems here. And you see these reactors we've set up in the site at Sonoma. We just last week collected stormwater. We got our permits for that, and we're testing these columns out in different combinations and flow rates. So that's the story with stormwater capture, treat, and recharge. And the last thing I wanted to mention was, could we think differently about how we imagine wastewater, water recycle, and stormwater management, and how they might work well together? And that's shown here in this slide, where you could imagine that you could take wastewater, treat it to a very high degree, as we do in California. You run it through microfiltration, reverse osmosis, advanced oxidation, and you produce a very high quality water. But how do you get that water into the public water supply? That's a challenge. But you could go from those plants over to these stormwater spreading basins that for about 8 months out of the year aren't doing anything. And so the question is, how might this treatment conveyance replenishment actually work? So we're talking about this idea here now. You do the advanced water treatment, put the water in the spreading ground, it goes into the ground, and then it gets pumped out later to go to the water treatment plant. What's interesting about this is stormwater infiltration basins and the water extraction, that infrastructure already exists. So it's really a question of thinking about, well, where would you put these treatment plants and what would the conveyance system look like? So this is an example of a spreading ground in Los Angeles. This is how it looks for most of the year. It's there's no water in it. So the thinking is, well, could you actually take wastewater, treat it to a high degree, and now put it into this stormwater spreading basin? And again, the advantage is that you're building one pipe, putting that water somewhere, and then it becomes part of your public water supply. Well, just a month ago, or 2 months now, the Metropolitan Water District is proposing something like this. Now, in Los Angeles, we have two great big treatment plants, one for the city of LA and one for the rest of the county. And what the Metropolitan Water District is proposing here is say, well, we could build one of these advanced wastewater treatment plants, maybe capture 150 million gallons, and then pipe that water to these different spreading basins. And this is very ambitious. To go inland, to the nearest one is about 15 miles away and 100 feet uphill. When you go a little farther, like to that arrow right in the middle, that's about, it's almost 30 miles and it's 500 feet uphill. And this, you know, this gets you back into this question now, is this the best system? So a student of mine, John Bradshaw, is working with the Southern California Water Committee and Bureau of Sanitation and Department of Public Works to kind of think this through. Now the Bureau of Sanitation and Department of Public Works, LA Department of Water and Power, that's all LA. And they look at this and they scratch their head a little bit and ask, is there a better way we might do it? And this shows what we've been thinking about here is that this circle down on the lower left, that's the big treatment plant for LA. So one idea is say, well, I put a water reclamation plant down there, pump it about 20 miles and 200 feet uphill into that spreading basin. Or do I build a satellite plant? And that's that one with the little cross in it. Should I build a satellite plant? And there, I'm only building a 10-mile pipeline, and it's all downhill. Well, what are the trade-offs there? Which one makes more sense? You know, how does this pencil out? You look at it and say, well, I don't know, but it sounds attractive to build the satellite plant because you have a short pipeline and you don't have to pump the water, flow downhill. And so for this work, we're fortunate to be able to look at some data from the Hansen Spreading Grounds where they put some recycled water there in that spreading ground. That's a system under construction, but it gives us good cost data and the like to work with. This system, when you look at it, there are about 26 spreading grounds in the LA area. They're different plants, and so the idea of the model is to work on these systems first and then expand out to get a bigger picture of how they all might work together. So I hope I've been able to tell you a bit about how we could help meet the urban water challenges in California. My take-home messages are that water recycling can be done in new and different ways that are very energy efficient, that will have decentralized systems that offer all those advantages that I mentioned and evolve new technologies. And the capturing the urban stormwater can contribute to the water supplies. It can enhance urban amenities, but we need to figure out how to do this in ways so we're not contaminating groundwater. And all of this depends on us being able to do some things at a reasonable scale in the field. First from pilot plants and then scale up to a demonstration facility. And we're fortunate where we are to have partnered with some forward-looking utilities and Stanford University that are giving us support in these ventures. So that's my message tonight, and I thank you for your attention. And Shubhashis, maybe we'll have time for a few questions if it's not too late. Thank you.
Thank you for the great presentation. So we definitely have time for questions.
I thought your question might go a little bit different direction at the beginning because you mentioned landscaping. And so in California, most of the water on average in a home is used outdoors. So when we talk about water, if I were going to, let's say you were the Sierra Club or the tree people, we would want to first talk about conservation and explain what's been done. We've done a lot in conservation. The problem is we really can't conserve our way out of this problem. If we conserve more, what it will accommodate is the population increase. We haven't solved the problem because your gallon per person goes down, but you have more persons, and it evens out almost. So we have to do something more. So part of your question here was about rain barrels, and the city does provide rain barrels to folks, and that's all good for public education. But when I think about the public education, it means really that when you go look at your rain barrel, it's empty because it doesn't rain for so long. That's why you need, I showed you the picture of the big tank. You need a huge barrel. And so the city will give you rain barrels and the like, and that's all, I think it's more awareness about the drought, and it makes you think about where the waters come from. So the challenge then, like Governor Brown, bless his heart, said, okay, cities, you need to reduce your water use by 25%. I live on the Stanford campus, and I'm close to the utilities people, and we're all watching, can we meet that goal? Well, if you do efficient irrigation, and if you have appropriate landscaping, the answer is yes, you can. If you're in an apartment, and you have low-flow toilets, and you have low-flow shower heads, and you have low water needs modern washing machines, you can't do too much more, easily. But we can all do a lot in terms of our landscaping. So part of the story is, if we're going to come up with new sources of water, we don't want to use that water to encourage inappropriate landscaping for our area. And cities will have buyback programs for getting rid of a lawn and stuff. And I don't have a lawn. I have a nice garden with lots of plants and manzanita and fruit trees, and looks nice. I think it does. I'm a gardener, but I don't have a lawn. So I think that was part of your question. The other one was about desalination, and I just happened to have a slide about that. So thank you. desalination, this is a topic of great interest in California, and the question is, why don't we just desal seawater? Now, San Diego is building the largest desalination plant in the Western Hemisphere. It's in Carlsbad, California. It's going to be going online this year, meaning 2016. And it'll provide about 50 million gallons a day. Now, why are they doing that? It's because they don't have a lot of options. It doesn't rain a lot there. They don't have good aquifers. They don't have, they don't have the right geology to store groundwater. When you looked at that pie chart for LA, that one I showed, with the circle and the Mayor Garcetti and the like, you say today, tomorrow. What was interesting on the tomorrow is there was no desalination there. Why? Well, in part because the community there, as represented by various groups, thinks that they can meet the water supply challenges without desalination, and desalination takes a lot of energy. So you would want to do, there are groups like the Sierra Club and others that don't want that to be done. You also have a brine to dispose of, and that could be very dense, and there's questions about that. But another thing you can do is say, well, let's not talk about desalinating seawater, look at wastewater. And I'm showing you the example of the same kind of plant that you would have in Carlsbad, except the feed for this plant is highly treated wastewater. And it goes through these steps, and you produce about 8 million gallons a day here in Santa Clara Valley Water District. It's not 50 million gallons a day, but it's demonstrating how the system will work with wastewater. That water at the what's called the Silicon Valley Advanced Water Purification Facility gets blended back into that recycled water to dilute the salt content. So right now it's being used to help make that water appropriate for irrigation. And that's that problem with the salts I mentioned. In time, they'd like to build out this plant and put that water into the ground or into a surface water reservoir. But an interesting story is if you look at the energy now, how much energy does it take to remove the salts from seawater? We're going to use these units of kilowatt hour per cubic meters. It takes about 3 from seawater. It takes half that from wastewater. So you save a lot of energy because you have less salt content. But if you were to use one of these anaerobic processes of the kind I described, that gives energy. Also, those membranes are finer than microfiltration. Now, in all this treatment for the desal and the like, there are 3 steps: microfiltration, reverse osmosis, UV oxidation. Here, that treatment provides that one step, and I think this number would almost go, it could be a bit less than that. So new wastewater treatment practices, anaerobic systems, membrane bioreactors, you know, that's a good water to think about desalination. Okay.
I'm just going to say that we have a floating microphone with Lauren, and there's a microphone here in the middle. We appreciate if you could come to get to either one of those microphones.
But desalination is always comes up, and it's not popular in Northern California, not popular in Santa Monica, but anyway.
Can you please comment on what Singapore is doing? I think they're also at the forefront of the...
Yeah. Singapore does what Orange County does. Orange County in the late 1970s started a process to look at how to reclaim wastewater for what they call groundwater replenishment and seawater intrusion barrier. And over about 20 years, they studied these different kind of processes, eventually settling on microfiltration, reverse osmosis, and UV light. And that plant that they built then was called the groundwater replenishment system, and it does two things. It puts water into the aquifer for extraction later, and it puts some fresh water right near the coast. So when you pump the water inland, you don't draw in salty water. What Singapore did is visit that site and basically copied it, and so, or adopted it. Now, what Singapore has done is gone on and built more plants, and so their plants are more up to date, but basically it's the same system. It's the same system as I showed there at the Silicon Valley Advanced Water Purification Facility. That one was 8 million gallons a day. That's just a replication of the Orange County system, you know, with a little newer equipment, because it's, you know, it's 2014 not, or 15, not 2002. But in Santa Clara County, in the Santa Clara Valley Water District, they say, well, we want to demonstrate that it can work here. And that's the nature of the utilities, is that, is they're risk adverse. But the point was in this is that with Orange County realizing that they had problems with saltwater intrusion, not enough water, what are they going to do? Then thinking very early about this water reclamation. And they took the step to do all this research and then to build a plant and demonstrate that it could work. And then people from all over the world come and look at that and then say, oh, yeah, this is great. Well, maybe we could do that here.
You talked about the importance of stormwater collection for recharging aquifers. What role do you think porous concrete could have in this?
Well, porous concrete will help with infiltrating water into the superficial aquifer. In Los Angeles, what happens with that infiltration is it doesn't make its way into the deep water-bearing strata. So it does prevent runoff. It does help, well, I would say, with trees and plantings and that kind of thing. But in terms of the water supply, that water has to find its way deep in the ground, and then that's where these recharge basins come into play. They happen to be in the wash of either the LA River or the Santa Ana River or the San Gabriel, and there are a few places around that have the right geology for that.
Would you happen to know by any chance how a computer engineer specifically could contribute to the development of this technology?
Like computer engineers.
Yeah, I don't know how, if at all.
I should have a ready answer for this.
Start by taking a course in environmental engineering, and then I'm sure you can but you may have a better suggestion.
I'm not so sure about, I don't have a off-the-cuff answer for you, to be honest. But what is interesting, you know, is that Stanford is located in Silicon Valley, and there's a lot of folks that are thinking, well, what's the role of venture capital in this work? Can't venture capital have a big role to play, and real quick things will change? I'm digging in my pocket here because I got a new iPhone. My wife and I went to the Apple store. Well, how often do you get a new iPhone? I don't know. Well, for me it was a number of years, but maybe these turn over every several years. well, what's the turnover in our urban water infrastructure? It's decades. It might be 40 years, maybe 50 years. So it doesn't turn over very fast. Also, the in the role of high tech and the like, I think it's a bit misguided to think you're going to make a ton of money. There's money to be made, but it's not quite as fast as this. Everyone needs a new one of these every few years. You don't want a new wastewater treatment plant every few years. There's a lot of, maybe I'm thinking now of where the opportunity comes in is in sensing and using computer algorithms to sense the system, to know when there are leaks, to do pressure management and the like. Some water is always lost through leaks, and we tend to operate our system as one pressure, and you could manage it as pressure districts better. Sensing and control, so I don't know if that's computer science, but it's so if we go to these satellite systems I described, what's the right scale of the satellite system? Well, one scale could be the Stanford campus, and you think, okay, with that, I could have an operator around. There's someone looking at it. But what if I go to much smaller? What if I go to the scale of a condominium complex or an apartment building? Who's going to run that? Well, you can't afford to have a full-time person there. So you say, well, I want to have good sensing and control and be able to watch all these things. And that's probably, so you have a central place that's following all this and will know when things are performing right or need some attention. But there was a question, the gentleman in the yellow shirt.
Thank you very much for the talk. I noticed that you did not talk about the economic side of the projects. How would it extend to the lifespan of the of any of those two main projects you talked about? And when considering that, would desalination appear as an appealing alternative? And also appear as a good project for future expansion, because desalination plant can be easily expanded rather than buying expensive land.
Right.
And with the risk also associated with anaerobic treatment. I am a big fan of anaerobic process, but adding expensive technology to separate CH4 from the other.
Well, just separating it out of water is a challenge too.
Yeah.
So those systems are not. There's an energy required to strip the methane out. You're right, because it's pretty soluble in water. So your question was about desalination and. I kind of lost. I was thinking about something.
Well, what's more practical from an economic viewpoint?
Cost. I'm sorry.
And cost economically not only means the money spent in capital or operation maintenance throughout the life cycle, but also in the risk associated and so on.
Yeah, right. I want to go back to this one picture I had of the, just scrolling through here. Oh, I can't remember where it was now. It was a desal plant. It was, but the thing that's interesting to look at is for the city of San Diego, they've contracted with Poseidon here to build the water reclamation plant, the seawater desalination plant. And their contract price is on the order of $2,000 an acre foot. Now you say, what's $2,000 an acre foot? Well, that's more expensive than what you may be paying now for imported water. But that's a false comparison, because there's no more cheap water to go buy. It's not like you may be paying $500 an acre foot and say, well, I'll just get more. There isn't any more. So the question is not how it compares with the price today, but how it compares with alternatives. Stormwater capture at these larger systems that I described can be on the order of maybe $500 an acre foot, $100 an acre foot. They're very efficient. Desalination, maybe it's $1,000 an acre foot, but it's not the same as seawater as $2,000. The place where the desalination has a role, I think, is I'm not completely against it. I think it has a role, and that's like as a piece in the pie chart. So, in other words, if you have more and different kinds of water being supplied, and if these systems can connect with one another, then you have greater resiliency and reliability. Even in the Bay Area, we've been talking about maybe we should have a small desal plant. Some groups like the Sierra Club are very opposed to it. I'm in favor of it. I'm thinking of earthquakes and the like, and that you could knock out your aqueduct, but then maybe the desal plant is located some miles, tens of miles from the aqueduct, and it might survive. But you want that kind of, I think you want that sort of portfolio. And as you said, also with a desal plant, you can scale it up if it turns out it's working good. You could build a 10 MGD or 20 MGD. You can just build out. So it does have a role. Huntington Beach is considering it very seriously. The challenge in part is how do you pull the water in without entraining marine organisms? And that means that in the case of Huntington Beach, there's discussion about submarine or seabed intake versus just a pipe. Well, the seabed intake, this becomes very challenging to build in deeper water over a broad area. You know, all this construction equipment out there, it effectively doubles the cost of the plant if they have to go that one feature. So, but will Huntington Beach go ahead with desal? I imagine they will. Will it be a subseabed intake? It might, probably will be, to get it to be acceptable. So there are real cost issues here for sure, but wastewater reclamation, stormwater capture, they're very attractive compared to alternatives. And these are things that utilities look at. And the other one I wanted to remind you about is, what's the alternative? It's not more cheap water. There isn't any more cheap water. And that's today. Yeah. I was going to explain something about my water bill, but I won't do that.
Okay. So we'll take a question here, but I know there are several questions out there. So maybe please get to the microphone in the meantime. Go ahead.
Well, thank you for your highly interesting presentation. And my question is kind of related to one of your last answer. I'm from a company which is a young Quebec company, which is called Aquartis, and we design and manufacture gray water recycling system for buildings. For example, we have a shower that a low-cost shower that recycle water and pump it back into toilet just beside. So you spoke about a decentralized system, like a satellite treatment, but I would be curious to know your opinion about, like, really decentralized.
So there are some signature examples of these gray water reuse in buildings, and the Solaire in New York City is one you might be familiar with. There's another facilities of buildings in Vancouver that do that, and it certainly has a role to play. For the average homeowner, when you think of gray water, now gray water means not toilet, not kitchen sink or dishwasher. It means like shower, laundry, and bathroom sink. That can be used for irrigation. If you bring it back into the house, it has to be treated. And that's where your systems may come into play. And so that's fine. And use it to flush toilets. That can make a big difference. Those systems have to be maintained. And so a question is do people maintain them? Or maybe your company provides that service. I'm not sure. But gray water use is attractive and plays for toilet flushing. But you have to have showers, so that's why apartment buildings, office buildings are not good. Most people don't take showers in an office building, you know. But in other, but the gray water is an all year round source of water, and so that's a good use. Now, I got to tell you a little story here. I'm chair of this committee of the National Research Council to look at beneficial use of stormwater and gray water. So what the city of Long Beach did is they surveyed a bunch of neighborhoods, and for about 30 homes, they said they would install free what they call laundry to landscape. That means where you take the washing machine water, and since it has a little pump on it, it's easy to build a system to put that water out to your garden. They built some 30 of these for different people, and then they monitored the water use before and after, and looking to see, okay, what are our water savings? Guess what? Water use went up. Out of 27 out of 30 homes, the water use went up. And now, why is that? We don't know. But it was, one could be, I mean, I would be inclined to think, well, I can take a long shower because, you know, it's just going to my garden. But there's something there, there's a social science aspect here about, and the city of San Francisco has seen the same thing too. So it's kind of interesting about what does it mean, why weren't the benefits realized in that? And so that's, your company may know that, maybe, or I don't know if there are any social scientists here, but you know, how do people think about the use of their water? If you use it to put in more landscaping, maybe that's what they did. Well, gee whiz, I got this water, now I can put in more plants or whatever. I'll put it a putting green. I mean, they didn't do that, but you know what I mean. It's an interesting thing to go study about that, about the gray water. But for my thinking on the gray water for use in buildings, it's not a home, but it's condominium complexes, it's apartment buildings and like that, bigger scale where you can have some oversight of how the systems work or hire your company to maintain it.
I'm wondering about, you said that there's been a lot done on conservation, really, so I'm wondering about the buybacks you mentioned on going into appropriate landscape. Have those turf replacement programs been effective?
So it was incentives to get rid of grass. So the Metropolitan Water District was paying people to take out the grass, and at one point it was $3.75 a square foot. And that program was so attractive that they ran out of money. They had some money set aside for that, and it depleted it. But those are, with that kind of incentive, people would do it, and they think they're doing the right thing. And the deal is with landscaping. I'm a gardener, and there are ways to make the grounds look good with manzanitas and olives and citrus. These are all plants that do well in our kind of climate. What doesn't do well are basically grass, you know, things from the Midwest that you took to California. So those plans are very attractive, and we'll see more in that. Las Vegas has done a lot of that too. And the Santa Clara Valley Water District has a program as well. But I think 375, that's about as much as I've heard for per square foot.
So we'll take a last question, and let's try someone else new. But if you could please come to the microphone, because that other one probably is not working well.
Well, my first point is more a comment on the landscape. I think there's a shift in mentality that has to happen from the how can we reduce the water consumption, so let's say by low flow irrigation, to why are we even using plants that require water? You know, so why not just do some, xenoscaping, so using, you know, greeneries that do well in drought water. So that's my little comment. And my question is there a time frame for the pilot project that you were mentioning?
The one at Stanford?
Yes.
Well, you saw its construction. That was a few weeks ago. The plant should come online early winter, January. And there'll be a long shakedown period, in part to get the microbial community to work, to get all the controls to work. And then we'll start running it probably for about 2 years or so. And then after about 2 years, you'll kind of know how it's actually performing.
Okay.
And that's to me, this is really exciting. I think the stormwater is really exciting. The decentralized systems are really exciting. And new technologies where you can reclaim water, essentially energy free. You think, gosh, what could be better? That sounds good to me.
Okay,
well, you've been a very gracious audience. I thank you for staying here on this evening when it's cold and all, and you had to come through the snow. At least in California, we call this snow. And thank you.
So I just want to thank Dr. Luthy for this wonderful presentation, and I had the privilege of learning from him how to turn contaminated water into clean water. I was starting about 20 years ago, and more importantly, learning the value of clean water. And I hope you had a good glimpse into the sort of things that Dr. Luthy has been working on and trying to make sure that we have sustainable solutions. So thank you all.
All right. Good night.